on phytochemistry of basically, we are basically working from marine natural product, but we do lot from invertebrates also, but basically I have included those things from algae. So that's what it could able to switch here. So thank you, Dr. Ramesh for nicely coordinating, and all my greetings to all the Vice President, Dr. Pradeep, Dr. Sanit, General Secretary, Joint Secretary, Treasurer, so everybody, all the office bearers. So I thank, I immensely thank Kerala Academy of Science for inviting me to give a talk, an invited talk on this very important topic, basically. So with your permission, permission of the chair, so may I just start?
Thank you. This is yours.
So, Dr. Ramesh, is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
So, I will start. So, this this is basically the topic is marine macroalgae as the treasure house of bioactive compounds and nutraceuticals. So, as you know, this this topic of nutraceuticals, particularly and bioactive compounds from the marine organism, is of immense importance, because particularly in this pandemic, so everybody would like to have medicine and food together. So, as Hippocrates told that old proverb, like let food be thy medicine. So that I think is very important, and very in nowadays condition of pandemic and all, I think people are looking for this, looking for naturally derived drug. Basically naturally derived compound rather than the synthetic derivatives. So basically very important, though this particular species called marine macroalgae, this otherwise they tell as a seaweed. Other day that World Food Laureate was, I was just attending a meeting, so Dr. M.B. Gupta is the World Food Prize Laureate. It's basically equivalent to Nobel Prize. So he was just mentioning that, this we should not tell as a, we should tell as a marine. Is not a seaweed, it's basically marine macroalgae, and tell about marine horticulture, the culturing of the, so how very important, and also government is giving a lot of emphasis on this particular culture of this particular cultivation of the particular species, marine species, so immense importance. And if you see in India, we are not yet habituated to take this marine macroalgae as food in our dishes. But if you go to Southeast Asian countries like Taiwan, particularly in Japan, I think you will be knowing that they are having like a wrapper, like a nori, they locally tell. So they take as a, like a breakfast item. So seaweed and all this very basically they are having in the food habits, they are inbuilt. And India also definitely it is going to come in the next few years. So as we know that about the ocean, we know very less about the moon. This is we know very less, because we could able to only explore some of the coastal areas of the ocean, but not into the deeper sea. I think deeper sea is having the greater resources. I think that is those are yet to be explored. But whatever we could able to explore from the coastal areas, I think it has given a lot of bioactivity, value added compounds, high value compounds. So definitely it is having an immense potential to develop products for health purpose, for functional food, and also to develop valuable pharmacophores. So now the question is, why actually we should really go for this marine chemical compound? So what is special in that? Because if you see that evolutionarily they have developed this organism, actually the first to develop, actually. So evolutionarily they, and also if you see their morphology, they don't have any appendages, mostly many invertebrates. Even the marine macroalgae also, they doesn't, though it looks like a plant, but it doesn't have any this one root, leaf, it doesn't have true leaf. They don't have true leaf, true root. So they are basically on the hold fast. So but they basically, I want to tell, they don't have appendages. So they have developed basically to fight, because as you know, the oceanic ecosystem is highly, adversaries are there, salinity is very high, high pressure at the depth. So they have to fight the adversaries in the oceanic ecosystem, and they have developed, and they don't have appendages. Most of the invertebrates also, algae, don't have appendages. So they have developed that chemical compounds inside their, them to fight the adversaries in the oceanic ecosystem. So this basically are very important, no, for as a natural product chemist, marine natural product chemist, whatever it is very interesting to this type of compound. So, and there are many reasons. So I'm not just reading on the slide, but no, this is the basic concept. And as you can see that E.O. Wilson in 1994, he has opined that this million years of testing by natural selection of made marine organism in chemistry, basically these are the chemical laboratories in of superhuman skill that the human cannot make. And also the next millennium, that's William Fenichel, so one of the pioneering marine natural product chemist. So he has told that this is the super medicines are going to come from, only from the ocean in future. So immense potential to develop the high value compounds from the marine organisms. So now naming this basically coming to the marine because particular topic, so I'll be focusing on marine macroalgae, though we are working on other invertebrates also from the marine. So this particular things I'll just focus on marine macroalgae or seaweeds, otherwise they tell us seaweeds or marine plants, whatever name, but marine macroalgae is more apt taxonomic classified name, accepted name. So basically they are exceptional storehouse of the bioactive natural products with the pharmaceutical and functional food, exceptional storehouse, just I was mentioning about. So these are actually I want to just like to tell some one of the review paper which has been published by Pereira and Pichle recently. So in Japan, basically I was telling that this Japanese having, if you see their life expectancy throughout the world, Japanese people having highest life expectancy among throughout, I think all different, one study was there, not only one study, there are various studies depicting that these people are having highest life expectancy. These are, they have attributed that they take lot of seafood as well as seaweeds. Particularly, the seaweed is a part of their food, breakfast, lunch, whatever it is. So they take seaweed as traditionally and regularly for regular food. If you go to Japan or these type of countries, I think you might have I think you might have seen this. They are in that breakfast dish or like a soup, they are taking as a seaweed, green color particularly. So they have in this review they have examined that, they have analyzed that. That the COVID infection initially in this particular Hokkaido, Japan, was very low initially, and they have corroborated the lower incidence of this particular COVID-19 with the higher consumption of marine macroalgae. And this basically as being used in China, Japan, Egypt, particularly Southeast Asian countries, and now also Europe, European and North America. Also they are India also is not far behind, so it will be definitely going to come in the next 4 to 5 years. You can see seaweed food or soup are being served in the hotels, or you can make in your house as a breakfast. So basically this having wide ranging commercial application also. So if you see seaweed particularly, I think everybody use agar in their laboratory for particularly microbiological I'm telling about researchers. Other than that, it is having several industrial applications. So agar is basically coming from the red seaweed, red marine macroalgae. So this is basically actually D-galactopyranose and 3,6 anhydro L-galactopyranose, basically this agar. And this is being used in any laboratories, like microbiological, for microbiological use. This is also from seaweed. Now this is one recent statistics from FAO 2020. Basically this is some of the statistics is 32.4 million tons weight valued around $13 billion. This is the FAO estimate for the marine macroalgae. And also aquaculture is being given a lot of importance for this particular species, because once you grow that in farm under no control condition, you get more regular supply. So that is also in world as well as in India are being taken up as a priority research aspect. So it's very important. And Indian marine, if India's part is concerned, I think it is more than 0.26 million tons of weight harvestable biomass belonging to around more than 700 species. See, if you go to any temperate countries and in India, the advantage of our agroclimatic thing is that ours is more of subtropical to tropical. So our variability of the species are far greater than that of the temperate countries. So you may not get many this much variability, maybe very less in the temperate countries, but in India variability is there. So there is a tremendous potential of the culturing of the marine macroalgae and developing compounds and having the wide range of applications. And among those, 6 species are economically reported to be important. So now the question is, see, why marine natural product? First of all, as I told you, you know, very less than the moon is largely the unexplored. So not, you don't know much of the things, even not even the tip of the iceberg. So approximately 71% of the molecular entities, this is very important, please note down, molecular entities listed in the dictionary of the natural products are the novel molecular structure. There is a dictionary of marine natural products. So you all know that there is a dictionary of the natural product, which encompasses, like you can go through SciFi Finder and all the things you can compare. So basically is having the novel molecular structure. And because marine life has evolved over a long period of time in severe and hostile conditions. So this is the preclinical, one of the preclinical cytotoxicity screen. You can see that higher incidence of pharmaceutical potential. Suppose you are working with the marine organism, you may have the greater probability to get the high value compound with a highly bioactive compound. So this is just like 1% if you get from the marine organism, you can get 0.1% from the terrestrial organism. So there is a higher probability. And also in recent days, it is coming up, though it is the marine natural product discovery. It is not a very old subject. It has started now, you can see 1950. So with that invention of azidothymidine, you will be knowing this particular compound, azidothymidine or judoveridine. There are huge number of patent application for this particular compound, which is one of the first marine drugs has been discovered against AIDS. Still date it is being used, but the problem is that with the compound having higher toxicity, it has been discontinued somehow, but activity wise, it is fantastic against this particular disease. So still being used, I think marine compounds, what I want to tell is very highly bioactive, having very highly bioactive properties. So this is basically the distribution of marine natural products from the some of the organisms, which I wanted to tell. This is taken from the review of the Blunt, 2016-17. So red algae, basically, you know, macroalgae is, can be classified into three different classes, red, brown, and green. Red actually predominates around 6%, followed by brown and green algae. Green algae, basically, we take it as a food in Southeast Asian countries. If you go, basically, they consume as a food item. So this is some of the studies in our laboratory. So basically, just know, we do basically how nutritionally, so we wanted to see that. See, if we can, green seaweed, if you can introduce as a food item in our breakfast. So basically, you should see that how much nutritional it is important. So we did detailed nutritional studies also and various type of seaweeds in different. So this is just like some of the screenshot of some of the bird's eye view of some of the works from in our laboratory. So you can see that N3 by N6 fatty acid ratios are very high and acceptable. No, it is more than one is very good. You can see some of them as having more than 1.56. All are satisfying the criteria, most of the series. So therefore, they are very good as a food item, as a nutritional item, other than several other bioactivity. So basically, it satisfied the criteria as being a true nutraceutical. Like you can develop a good nutraceutical agents. Like you give bioactivity, you give also nutrition. So this is basically, see how we can understand a particular area is such an important. So basically, you know, it is not only publications. Publications will be many, but patenting trends. So that you can, it is a ready reckoner. Like we can, if you can understand, okay, this is the particular patent filed or how many patents filed and who are, which are the countries on this particular work, you know, niche area they are working. So we can understand, okay, this is the particular area is really important and people are working on that and worth studying. So you can see most of the things are basically filed from granted from the Chinese Academy of Sciences and the China are working basically a silent player on this. They don't tell much things, but huge work is going on in their country. So so they are actually basically the leader. If you can see that no patent granted on this particular area of seaweed research and utilization. This is some of the studies we did in 2018, basically we did some studies. On 2018. So these are some of the basically nutraceutical products. So of the our institute has developed. So all of them have been commercialized against arthritis, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, hypothyroidism, and latest was immunoboost extract, which and also osteoporosis, which have been commercialized this month. Yes, the 7th of September 2021, we were able to license to one of the prominent pharmaceutical company. So now basically it's nutraceuticals is causing a paradigm shift in healthcare. So earlier it was drug, now nutraceuticals is causing a paradigm shift. So if you can see the global nutraceutical market, this we wanted to tell no, how 2019 data, basically, you can see the, basically, if you see the Southeast Asian countries, Japan is the leader, and then followed by Europe, Japan, China, Europe, and then America somewhat. But India is not that, no, is not there in that list, but it is, of course, you can see that, no, things plot will be changed in next 4 to 5 years. So this is the nutraceutical market by size region. You can see that high, like Asia and Europe, that is medium is in America, and of course low Africa and Latin America. So this we have borrowed from Order Intelligence. So this is also the, some of the patent grants in the subject of, so we did in Darwent Innovation, we have used Darwent Innovation earlier, Thomson Reuters. So basically we did some studies and tried to know landscape, how many patents are there on the marine macroalgal nutraceutical from the area from 1995 to 2019. You can see it was not there up to 1999. So 2002-3 slowly growing, but really it has been pushed up from 2005 when no process patenting came into picture in Indian patent scenario. You know, you all know the process patent, it has given a lot of boost in filing an Indian patent, particularly generic drug. You all know pharmaceutical stories, how pharma companies are going for generic drug and not for new compound. This is all known story, I should not repeat this here. So basically a huge surge of patent granted on this particular area of nutraceutical. The graph tells itself. So these are some of the patents granted. There are many patents. Just trying to tell some of the bird's eye view of some of the patents filed. I mean, Chinese, Taiwan, and US. So this is the world patent. So some of the area of seaweed nutraceuticals. So I'm not going into much detail of all this because it will consume a lot of time. So I just wanted to brief my presentation. So these are some of the things we have also granted. Been recently, this month also, we granted a patent for dyslipidemia from marine macroalgae. So these are some of the ICRC-MFRI working as a pioneering institute. We being like you are working, our major mandate is working on seaweed developed and utilizations. So this is the number of publications, the bioactive properties of marine macroalgae. This is the landscape of this diagram. You can understand now what are the type of activities generally, you know, as we have been studied from marine macroalgae. You can see antioxidant is higher, around 40%, followed by anti-inflammatory, anti-diabetic. So this is a pie diagram try to represent. So this also we did a study from by using Darwent Innovation from 1990 to 2020, and you can see the distribution. So these are some of the compounds basically which we could which also are there. Terpenes occupy the major share, followed by sterol, oligotides, alkaloids, etc. So as I told, this marine macroalgae is basically a storehouse of bioactive compounds. Like Southeast Asian countries, you can get it like a food item. So hugely taken, consumed as a food item. So if you see marine macroalgae, some of the products you will all be knowing, like agar, alginate. Basically, alginate, a valuable industrial raw material as a user, as a stabilizer, agar. I'm not going to repeat. I think you all know this, how important this compound is. We all use daily this IBDA also marketing different grades of agar. Carrageenan and also is a sulfated polygalactone, basically beta D galactopyranose, 3,6-7,2 D galactopyranose linked to alpha 1,3 and beta 1,4 linkage, basically as you can see here. So alginate polymer, glucose is a linear polymer of glucose, glucuronate and manouronate, GM residues, linear polymer basically. Basically one from the red, alginate you can get from brown marine macroalgae. So these are some of the examples of some of the compounds like brominated aromatics, nitrogen heterocyclic. So these are just various. So you can go through the, even you can get in SciFinder, there is a dedicated soft database called the MarineLeet, which you can, if you can understand, I think we can get huge amount like how it is been added to each year. So they are basically, earlier it was New Zealand based company. So basically they have like given license to an UK based company. So now they are updating that number of bioactive compounds each and every year. So we can get, so I just wanted to give a bird's eye view. So some of the companies where you can in India and their products, these are some of the companies which are basically, there are not many companies which are like commercializing and marketing and producing on this particular marine algae based product. These are some of the best companies. So Pioneer Pharmaceutical, Accelerated Freeze-Drying Company, Jaja Pharmaceutical, Snap Alginate in Vellore, Aqua Agri Processing Limited in Manamadurai. So Delhi, the Manamadurai is the factory, Delhi is the headquarters, this one. So marine hydrocolloids, Thai Media Laboratory. So these are some of the examples from India who are working on marine macroalgae based nutraceutical industries. So these are some of the works in our laboratory. So we have developed. So these are the some of the things also is a very valuable pharmacophores for the synthons, as the synthons are synthetic, templates to develop a future drug candidates. So this basically library is very important also. So our institute could able to develop the library of marine macroalgae, the various marine macroalgae species available from the coastal area. And also we are working on hemisynthesis of some of the compounds and also synthetic roots of some of the compounds. So this is Terminaria conoides. Locally they tell as a pakoda pasi in Tamil Nadu. So this also we got a huge number of bioactive compounds, many bioactive compounds, which is also undergoing several trials also, like toxicity trials, and also some of the synthetic roots we are being undertaken. So also we have worked on some of the things like, while as you know, the polyunsaturated fatty acid, there are several products in the market. However, as you know, this they are having many non-conjugated double bonds, olefinic bonds here. So that also induces lot of instability, because it causes peroxidation and it become like a conjugated olefinic bond. So therefore, nutritionally it is not valuable. It will become toxic if it become conjugated. So basically you should maintain the structure and also the cis configuration of the particular double bond. You should not be trans. So stability, inducing stability also very important. So seaweed, you could able to get some of the compounds from the seaweed. So patent is being filed in this particular area. You can see the induction time is very high, like more than 4.5 hours as compared to the general products. Like you can get only minutes, maybe the induction time is very low. Induction time is basically will tell how long it can be stable on cell. So these are the technology, because if you see this, these nutraceuticals are from not only seaweed, from other organisms. So we did some landscaping in 2019 to see that really which area of this one, fisheries and processing and all, which area is given lot of industrial commercializations are there. If you see the functional food supplement products and nutraceuticals from health from the sea, it is very less, only 2%. So I think it should be given a lot of emphasis, because there are high value species. So given a lot of in recent days, it is given a lot of emphasis to develop high value compounds and products. And our institute also able to, this is some of the screenshot glimpses of some of the products being commercialized, have been being commercialized to the several pharmaceutical companies, including VLCC, Pioneer, Accelerated, and some of the things I have just flagged here. So now Indian nutraceutical market is nearly around 400 million people living in India. Is a huge market basically. If you go to Singapore and the small type of countries and places, you can see there are huge, it's flooded. So some of the things if you go, some of the shops, it is only flooded with the nutraceutical products. In Dubai market, in Europeans also, they are becoming very, very, is becoming a very important. Now in Cochin also, where I stay in this particular area, so I could able to notice, there was one pharma shop, like he used to sell medicine. But suddenly I have seen one find, it has been changed, shop name is changed, nutraceuticals. So I just entered into the shop. Why, he was telling, see, nowadays people want drugs, like health from the directly health food, like as a nature derived health food. So nobody is much, so that's what he has changed the shop now, he has given. So that they tells how important is being imbibed into the markets, and all general people also are aware so how important this natural drug is. So as you can see, the multinational investing in the area of the nutraceutical market. If you see the portfolio in few years back also, you may not be able to see much of the products, nutraceutical products in the portfolio of this type of multinational company. But in recent days, if you see, that thing has totally changed. Like Monsanto, DuPont, and American Home Product, Abbott, and all the GlaxoSmithKline, some of the leading companies, as you all know. So their portfolios are also flooded with the many nutraceutical products. So India also is not far behind. We are having Dabur India, Cadila, British Biological, Himalaya, Swami Laboratory. So they are also pari nutraceuticals. So they are also nowadays undertaken a lot of research. There are in-house research also there. They have built up their in-house research, other than licensing from other institutes also. So they have spent a lot of money on the in-house research of this particular area of nutraceuticals. So that's what it is, first to gaining acceptance to fill the nutritional and health gaps in the daily diets, and also it improves immunity. Government is giving also a lot of emphasis, they have developed boom of e-commerce with wellness becoming one of the largest and fastest growing categories. You can see the nutraceutical market. I wanted to depict as a graphical representation. So how it is changing from 2010-11, now you can see 2019-20. So that itself reflects. So how it is growing, it is a growing subject. So if you compare the global nutraceutical market vis-a-vis with the Indian one, so this just to tell dietary supplement, functional food is occupying as a major share, functional beverage, functional food. And if you see in the world, Japan, US, also France, European countries, Germany are also is taking major share. They are compounded annual growth rate, which tells around more than 15 billion in 2025 from a meager $4 billion at like they have projected in 2025, it should be $18 billion CAGR. So marketing in the macroalgae based Asia Pacific, as I told, is very important area, leading regional market, North America, followed by Europe, as per data from the Source and Data 2019. And also I have because if you all know this World Integrated Trade System, which has been regularly they update by World Bank Group. This I have taken the data from 2020 data of export and import of polymer, natural alginic acid, salt, ester and nutraceutical basically. There are other, they are using in different HS codes basically. You can get it from the site, different HS codes. This is one of the HS codes, which I didn't mention here. But you can see here, there are a lot of export and import and different countries have been mentioned. So there are a lot of trades on this particular area of marine macroalgal nutraceuticals. So now what is the, I have just now, I didn't want to expand my presentation because already I think we are late and I thought maybe more of discussion, maybe there rather than telling slides. So basically, what is the future of marine drug discovery? So as you know, William Gravy, so one of the pioneering marine natural product chemists in his 2020 review, he told 7 clinically useful and approved drugs from 22,000 molecular entity, like one drug per 3,140. See, this is much above the industrial average. So industrial average is actually one in 5,000 to 10,000 tested compound. If you get that, it is great. But you can get more, better than you can cross the limit, you can cross the threshold in if you can, it is from the marine organisms. So this is of course in general, not from macroalgae. This he has deep from the all the marine organisms. So basically, what are the options for sustainable production of marine natural products? These are the some of the options. You can go for chemical synthesis, as I earlier told. See, if you develop a particular pharmacophore, and you cannot, suppose you can get from some species what you cannot get, that is there. See, unlike terrestrial organism, like terrestrial means you can farm it in the particular area, and you can get it always. You can get it a quantity, huge quantity, because land is there. But marine problem is that it is not within our control. Unless you do a develop a mariculture technology, so it is really, really very tough job. So maybe one organism you get today, tomorrow you may not get. So the thing is that in that case, you can concentrate yourself and research for chemical synthesis. Like you identify the particular compound, and you can develop the pharmacophore candidate. You can develop biosynthetic things like a top-down approach. I have not told all the things in great detail here. So also controlled harvest means you can harvest some of the things like what are widely available in this particular area. And again, it regrown after some particular time. And also, of course, mariculture. So you can grow this marine macroalgae under controlled condition and you can supply. So these are some of the future prospects over the last few years. Use of marine macroalgae for the development of high value compound, as I already told, our institute developed a heterotrophic database of bioactive molecules from the Indian marine macroalgae against different disease, particularly lifestyle disease. And as you know, now it is growing at a compound annual growth rate. If you see world growth rate, it is around 7%. Or India, it is now growth rate is around 20% for the past 3 years, particularly the segment of functional food, antioxidant, immunity boosters. So that itself tells we are going to occupy a major share. So keeping in by our resources, keeping in mind of our resources, I think we can be the leaders in future 4 to 5 years in this particular area. So dietary supplement segment constitutes around more than 60% of the nutraceutical market and growing. These are some of the statistics. I'm not just going to read those things. So Indian market at present imports 2.7 billion worth of nutraceuticals. See, government of India also is giving a lot of emphasis of this type of product. So they have temporarily opened up 100% foreign direct investment in this manufacturing sector under automatic route. and has increased. This FDI has increased from US$131 million to 2022, 2019 around 584 million. So that's what is very important. So just this I want to conclude by mentioning this, that these are basically natural drug. Basically, if you see the definition of the nutraceuticals, nutraceuticals are actually, you know, coined by Stefan de Felice, which initially he has defined that as a natural rare drug, basically because you are concentrating the, developing the method basically to concentrate a particular active ingredient which are particularly responsible against some particular disease or causing some health benefit. So we identify that and concentrate, develop the technology. So basically it is a natural derived drug, and advantage being that since it is a natural derived drug also, the in general it is coming under GRIS category. So toxicity is very less. Our studies also have shown that LD50 value and all the studies, like a toxicity study starting from acute, subchronic and chronic acute toxicity study particular. In particular, the LD50 value has shown more than 4,000 to 5,000 milligram per kg body weight. That itself tells you, it is absolutely, it is like a food item. So you have to take care of your health and as well as your well being. So this is a basically fast proliferation of the specific segment of nutraceutical. But the major problem we are facing, basically this greatest challenge remain to formulate the regulatory guideline to enable physicians. Basically physicians is no very skeptical to prescribe this group of specialized medicine. I think this remains the greatest challenge, and regulatory guidelines should be there on this particular area, so that now, other than selling online or OTC and all the products like selling in other routes, I think it can be physicians should be able to prescribe. So that is the greatest challenge, and regulatory guidelines should be formulated in this direction. So with that, I thank again Kerala Academy of Science, particularly Professor G.M. Nair for kindly inviting me, and all the office bearers of the Kerala Academy of Science, and my director Dr. A. Gopalakrishnan sir for kindly nominating me to attend this program. With that, I, and also all the delegates of this, no, who has no been patience to listen, and students in particular, if they are there, scientists, professor, everybody. So thank you one and all.
Thank you, Kajal, for taking us through the fathoms of the ocean where natural drug in the form of nutraceuticals and bio and natural products offer several challenges, several avenues to improve our health, particularly in this pandemic season time also, and which will indirectly, which will directly contribute to the economy of our country and the whole world, particularly the GDP. The G in this case can be green development, green domestic product. So the, as envisaged in the Biodiversity Act also, Kajal mentioned about controlled harvesting and sustainable utilization. Let us cultivate that philosophy of sustainable utilization even when it comes to exploration of the fathoms of the ocean. So the natural, so actually we are in the process of turning to nature for our all our problems, and nature has the answer for our problems, even including our diseases. Kajal already mentioned that we know very little about the ocean resources. Probably we know more about the moon than the ocean, the depth of the oceans. And since we have around 7,500 kilometers of coastal line, we are the owners of rich source of natural nutraceuticals and natural products. Let us bioprospect them for our need and not extract them for our greed. So contributing to the sustainable development goals, one of the most challenges, as Kajal mentioned, is how to regulate it, being in the fathoms of the ocean, how to regulate it. But we have the National Biodiversity Authority, and Ministry of Environment is contemplating, with the help of even CMFR. I remember attending a meeting when I was in the State Biodiversity Board about the exploration of the area beyond the beyond which comes under our control, the international waters. So let us cheer, let us congratulate Kajal Chakravarti for do and ICM and FCMFRI for doing that wonderful work, making available nutraceuticals for our citizen and for the citizen of the whole world. Thank you very much. If there are any question to be addressed to Kajal, you are welcome to do that.
Dr. Kajal.
Yes, sir.
An excellent lecture. I'm extremely happy to know the extent of work that you are doing at CMFRI and the contributions that you have made. We have been hearing a lot of the products which are extensively used, like agarose, agar, alginate. But then why is it that in spite of all the nutritional values, that most of those natural nutraceutical products from marine algae has not reached the market, or maybe has not become favorable nutraceutical commodities for the common man in India? Maybe the world market is very high. Is it lack of awareness, or maybe that we don't understand the nature properly, that people are not taking much of nutraceuticals based on marine products? Could you please just say a few things about it? Reason. I just want to know the reason. Why is it so?
Thank you, Professor Nair, for the question. Actually, you are right, because as far as awareness is one of the factor, because as you have rightly mentioned, that agar, alginate, and carrageenan. So this is basically used. If you see agar, it has been used in microbiology, any laboratories, and different rates of agar. But agar is not that much nutritionally important. So there are basically other components in the seaweeds which are of nutritional and pharmacological importance. Carrageenan, of course, they are having nutritional value but it is being used for different industrial uses, not generally actually focused, because probably they could able to find better market on this particular marketing of the nutraceutical, like ice cream industries, and huge, like they feel nutraceutical is a very, very new subject area. So generally, these companies doesn't want to take risk on this particular something to develop. But in recent days, but important thing is that basically as a scientist or as a institutes, it is our duty to develop the database, like how important as a nutritional or pharmacological compounds are available in these very important resources. So we could able to develop, I think last few years it has happened, we could able to develop, I think not only in India, in abroad, several countries, we could able to profile that the various bioactive compounds other than agar and alginate. So which are of immense pharmaceutical importance for human well-being. And also in particular, our institute is concerned, we have developed technologies to develop scale up so that it should be industrially feasible. So another problem of that is a challenge. See, you can do work in laboratories, maybe very important bioactive compounds you can get, but very lower yield. So generally pharma companies, they are not interested to even very huge yield, like, even crossing standard, they are not interested. But you have to really develop process, how is the greater yield and bioactivity. So you have to have a compromise among both. So these things, I think it is coming up in recent days. Of course, as Professor Nair rightly told, so I think a lot of people are getting, as I told that near our place where I stay in Kochi, so one shop also has been changed in nutraceutical. So definitely it is going to imbibe. In 2025, I think we can going to see a sea change in this particular area of nutraceuticals for health purpose.
Dr. Kajal, are there any anti-nutritional factors? Probably when you speak of marine seaweeds, as you said, you should not call them as weeds. They are valuable organisms. So maybe that what I feel is that there needs to be an extensive study on the allergy problems, on the toxicity reactions, anti-nutritional factors, like what you extensively do with the terrestrial plants. And also, as Dr. Umman has rightly pointed, we need to have organized cultivation rather than exploiting it the wild, the marine wild. So maybe that also has not become much more popular. Harvesting them through cultivation. I think these are some of those factors to be addressed. I feel there is a scope, great scope, in marine materials, which could take us to greater industrial development, especially I feel new possibility. Of course, the other compounds, you know, the medicinal compounds, there are few compounds which are extensively being used. Or they are found in medicines we are being prescribed. But I'm worried about the nutraceutical part, because that's what is very important. Looking at the kind of nutraceutical components contained in marine algae.
Thank you, GM. Thank you, Kajal, for that wonderful session.